great pleasure to introduce our honored guest, Karen Pence. Wife of Vice President Mike Pence, is a mother, an educator, an award-winning watercolor artist. As Second Lady of the United States, Mrs. Pence works to bring attention to art therapy and also to the sacrifices made by military service members and their families. Mrs. Pence is the honorary chair of the Art Therapy Initiative at Riley Hospital for Children at Indiana University Health in Indianapolis. She is also a member of the Riley Children's Foundation. She also serves on the board as a member of Tracy's Kids, an art therapy program for young cancer patients. In October of 2017, Mrs. Pence launched the Art Therapy Initiative, Healing with little H, little E, big A-R-T, with heart. She wants to elevate the profession so that people understand that art therapy is a mental health profession, and not arts and crafts, to help people understand that art therapy is an option for various conditions, illnesses, and life experiences, and to also encourage young people to go into the profession. Given this background, it's altogether fitting that Mrs. Pence assist us in awarding this year's Military Child Education Coalition's Art Awards. Let's give a warm MSEC welcome and welcome Mrs. Karen Pence to the stage.
Thank you so much. Boy, I love to be in a room of educators. I feel like I'm home. You're my people. Thank you, General Frazier, for that kind introduction. And I commend you on your leadership and commitment to military families. And thank you also for your service to our country. The extraordinary work of the Military Child Education Coalition, as you already know, serves a very important purpose. Thank you for all that you do to help military-connected children in our country thrive in the areas of academic opportunity and excellence, school transition, and developmental needs. You know, as a mother of a Marine, I can tell you without reservation that Americans have a special place in their hearts for those who fight to protect our freedoms. But we know it's not just the military members who serve. The spouses and children serve too. That's right. We have a daughter-in-law who serves too. So I applaud all of you who are participating in this year's training seminar. I know many of you work in school districts as teachers and counselors and administrators, and have military-connected students in your classrooms. You know, as an educator myself, I understand and appreciate the time and passion that you invest in our children. Thank you for your service. People do not understand the amount of time that teachers and administrators and counselors put in. They don't have any idea. But I do. So with that being said, it is such a pleasure to be here this morning. You know, military families hold a special place in my heart. I was actually born on a military base in Kansas, but we moved shortly afterwards because my father retired from the military. So I don't know what it's like to live with a parent who is an active member of the military. But through my travels and visits to military bases in the United States and all around the world, I'm learning more about life in the military. Since starting my role as Second Lady of the United States, I've participated in numerous roundtable discussions with military spouses, and through those listening sessions, I've heard parents discuss the hardships that their children face with frequent relocations and their emotional impact. You know, I don't understand what it's like to be that military child, but and I'm sure all of you can relate to being new at some time in your life. I was new in seventh grade, and all through sixth grade, I'd been this popular little girl at my school and had lots of friends. And when I went to seventh grade, I was ostracized, and I was the one nobody wanted to be friends with me. I wore the wrong kind of socks on the first day, and from there it went downhill. But they had been cool at my other school, so I thought I was being cool. But it was part of my story, and it changed me, and it helped me be more compassionate. And I think that was a time in my life where I started to see, you know, I need to help kids who are new and people who are new in situations and help with congressional spouse orientation. It really changed me, and I know that it's being used for these kids to change them too, but it doesn't mean that it's easy. We have about 2 million children who have a parent currently serving in the armed forces. On average, they experience 6 to 9 changes in school during their K through 12 education. This can lead to a lot of stress and may cause depression and anxiety. In addition to encouraging military service members and their families, I also champion art therapy, and the two kind of marry together. I believe offering art therapy in school districts and on military bases would be an invaluable option and would help military-connected children cope with their struggles, and I'm going to tell you why. Art therapy is a mental health profession that uses the creative process of art making to improve and enhance the physical, mental, and emotional well-being of individuals of all ages. Is there anyone here from Florida today? How about Indiana? Oh, one, yay! And I just mentioned Florida because Florida has art therapy in a lot of their schools. We actually announced our initiative in Florida. But art therapy is not arts and crafts. And I know that because I was an art teacher. And I'm not an art therapist. I could not do what they do. So art therapy is not arts and crafts. An art therapist who has, at a minimum, a master's degree, guides their client through art making to unlock the emotions that the client is trying to understand. You know, the side of the brain that's affected by trauma is not the verbal side. And so when you go through trauma and stress and you can't talk about it, and you don't know why you can't talk about it, the art unlocks those emotions. I've participated in discussions with art therapists and their clients and observed art therapy programs all over the world and all over the United States. In March, I visited Fort Belvoir Creative Forces, located in Fairfax County, Virginia, not very far from here. And there I observed an art therapist session with a military family, including 9-year-old Lucy and 6-year-old Tag. While I sat with the family, I watched the art therapist lead the family in creating a mandala using a variety of art-making materials and a large piece of paper. They all just put their own thing on there. The dad had been wounded while serving in Afghanistan, and he's healed quite a bit through art therapy. His children and his wife have also found healing through art therapy. And the art therapy sessions allow the children, as well as the service member, to express themselves through art. And they've been able to talk about their dad's recovery because it affected them too. I saw another example of art therapy helping kids deal with their emotions when I visited Methodist Children's Hospital in San Antonio earlier this year. Okay, let's hear it for Texas. I know you have a lot of people from Texas here. I joined several children in an art therapy session led by the art therapist, but I received a note from a patient who was unable to leave her hospital room. And in the note, she said, "I use art like 97% of my day. Art therapy is my favorite therapy here, especially since I can't leave my room." The art therapist told me that the young girl has responded very well to art therapy and it has become a way for her to express her feelings and find some enjoyment. Art therapy changes lives, and I like to say it saves lives. I've heard our service members tell me that before their art therapy, they were suicidal, and they'll look at me and say, I don't go to that dark place anymore. We know it works because research is underway at various medical facilities around the country. Dr. Thomas DeGraba, a nationally recognized clinical neuroscience subject matter expert, works at Walter Reed. And there, they're doing research. And he told me that there's evidence. He actually showed me pictures, and he said there's evidence that art therapy actually changes the brain. The brain is malleable, and it can be changed, and you can change those pathways. With that said, art therapy can really help our military-connected children and their parents, too, when they're having a hard time with the challenges that they face while serving our country. Art therapy has the power to heal beyond our belief, and it brings change for those children. So this morning, I encourage you, in your individual states and communities, try to foster some connections with art therapy and art-making opportunities for these military-connected children. I just want to thank this organization again. It's so amazing to have so many people out here concerned about helping our military-connected children and to help them overcome some of these challenges. It's difficult for them, and a lot of professions have this struggle. Our youngest had to move back to Indiana for her senior year of high school, and it was tough for her as well. But for these kids to move so many times, can really affect them. I love the fact that this competition helps these children to express themselves. Where are our award winners? Because I want to talk just to them. Are they out here yet? Okay, one, two, three. Okay, over here. I want to tell you guys a little bit about something, because today we're here to honor you. That's what I'm here for. The rest of the day is other stuff, but for this little part... I shouldn't say today, but for this little part, we're here to honor you. And I looked at your artwork, and I read your artwork, and I just want to tell you a story. You know, I started doing art shows when my kids were little. I stopped teaching for about 9 years, and I started to do art shows. And when people started to buy my artwork, it was so amazing for me. It was so validating. But my sister-in-law, for a birthday present 1 year, gave me this necklace, and it's a palette, a painter's palette. And when she gave me that, it meant so much to me because she saw me as an artist. And we see you, you three, as artists. Yeah. So today we're here to validate you and to say that your artwork touched all of these lives. And so I'm excited now. I know this is the next portion where we get to give you your award. So thank you so much to all the educators for being here today. This has been a privilege.
Military Child Education Coalition, Call for the Arts, received submissions from all over the world from every branch of service representing a wide range of age groups. Students submitted essays, poems, drawings, paintings, and interpretations of what it means to be a military child. Our first awardee for the Military Child Education Coalition, Call for the Arts, is LaJoyce McRue. LaJoyce is a 17-year-old senior at Douglas Anderson School of the Arts in Jacksonville, Florida. She's the eldest child of retired Petty Officer First Class Stephen McGrew and Cheryl McGrew. For the past 6 years, her artistic abilities have been broadened by attending art magnet schools in Duval Canyon. She loves creating artwork that connects her to various parts of life through mediums like paint, ink, pen, and charcoal. Her artwork is very clear on what it means and what its meanings can be, which includes happy feelings and dark feelings. LaJoyce plans to continue her love for art and serving others by majoring in art in the fall of 2019. LaJoyce is joined today by her parents and her extended family. Let's hear it for LaJoyce McGrew. Next awardee for the MSEC Call for the Arts is Hannah Oberdorf. Hannah is a rising ninth grader at Kinnick High School in Yokosuka, Japan, and her father is currently serving in the Navy. Hannah has been interested in drawing since an early age, drawing stick figures at age 3 and people with proper bodies at age 5. Hannah has used art as a way of winding down, relaxing, and thinking, and uses doodling as a way to express the way she views the world and how she feels. One of her favorite renderings is to sketch people she sees on trains. Hannah is interested in attending a college with an animation artistic focus, such as Carnegie Mellon, the Rhode Island School of Design, or the California Institute of the Arts. Hannah is joined today by her mother, Tara Oberdorf, and her grandparents, Jack and Diane Frampton, and John and Ann Oberdorf. Let's hear it for Hannah Oberdorf. Final awardee for the MSEC Call for the Arts is Mary Elizabeth Ray. Mary Elizabeth is a daughter of United States Air Force Colonel Bill Ray and Mrs. Susan Ray. She is currently a freshman at the College of Charleston and has used journaling as a tool to sort through her feelings and emotions since elementary school. Mary Elizabeth finds that writing about her experiences makes her feel seen and understood even if no one is looking or listening, and that the simple act of expressing her thoughts in the form of doodles and written journal entries takes all the weight off her shoulders. Mary Elizabeth is joined today by her mother, Susan Ray. Let's hear it for Mary Elizabeth Ray. Let's have a final round of applause for all of our award winners. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage the President and CEO of the Military Child Education Coalition, Dr. Mary Keller.
I just really want to thank you, Mrs. Pence. Thank you for being a teacher. Thank you for being an encourager of the arts. And just thank you for giving these kids a chance of a lifetime for you to recognize them as artists. Thank you.